born in 1999. Today, he has amongst us a thousand personalities from the Indian food industry, Mr. Poonachan. Mr. Poonachan is the business head of food specialties division of ICF Group. In his long career, spanning over 30 years in the food industry, he worked with the DuPont Nutrition and Health, Priya Foods, and Anisco Pharmaceuticals. Currently, he is responsible for the ICF Food Specialties business growth in South Asia. In his career in the Indian food industry, he drove various roles in R&D, operations, business development, product management, and business strategy. His association spans across the dairy, bakery, beverages, and the meat processing industries. He specializes in the protein, nutrition, beverages, and the processed meat. He holds a degree in the food technology from UDCT, University of Bombay, and a postgraduate diploma in the business management from the International Management Institute, New Delhi, India. Sir, may I now invite you to enlighten us with your words of wisdom.
What I'm going to talk today is one of the things is about flexibility, so I need to be present. Yeah? When I was contacted by your institute, I first did not understand what I'm supposed to do and why I am contacted. So till yesterday I had no clarity. I just went ahead and came, and I've been asking almost every other faculty and student that have been meeting me since yesterday, what do you expect from me? That what I took the message is that you would like to learn from corporate deals. Is that right? Okay. I'm in corporate world. In corporate world, it's a daily war, as you know. So I don't have big messages. I'm not a preacher, first of all. I'm not a guru. Nor am I a teacher. When I was looking at all of you when I entered this hall, a feeling crept in my mind. Oh, sorry, these guys are subjected to 3 days of grueling messaging from corporate leaders, and I'm sure at the end of the 3 days you will get a similar message from everyone. Okay? So I decided, after giving you a message, I will tell you a story. A story of myself. Right? And I link it with what Mr. Mundial has been talking to you, which is pretty much the message I have for you. So in that journey, if you can connect any messages, then I leave it to you to take. And when we come to the management institutes, we study lots of things and we talk about big corporate successes, the Bill Gates of the world, the Jack Ma's, the Zuckerbergs. But that's not what we are going to do. If one among this crowd comes, then. But generally, if you are going to be a Bill Gates or somebody, pardon me for saying this, we won't be sitting there. Right? So we'll be doing some creative thinking outside of the institute. So when we come to the institutes, what we do, we basically come here, with some exceptions of course, to get a degree. Thinking that this degree will give us a good job and a good life, and we go out and make our lives, provide money, and positions maybe. But unfortunately, for me, that's not so. For me, the institute that gives you a learning throughout the life is your own life. These institutes are passing phases. So that's what I have learned. I was introduced by Ansh as a stalwart in the industry, right? So that's what you have defined me, but not me. I don't think I'm a stalwart. But I wanted to be a stalwart when I started my journey. But I don't think I've even arrived, but I'm going to finish 30 years of industrial life, professional life. But mentally, I still feel I'm one among you. I've not grown up in that sense. Though years I've added on my gray hair. When you go out, join a corporate, you guys know the, I think lots of marketing guys are here, you know the visions and missions and the strategies and the core values. Right? Core values you heard of, right?
Yes.
Lots of companies have nowadays core values. And when I was looking at what are these core values, there are hundreds of them. hundreds. And most of them you hear safety, transparency, right? And environmental, and being in a team, honesty, integrity, whatnot, and so many things. So these are the core values which the corporation, the company, defines for itself. But when we go out and join a company, those are the core values we are given on day one. By HR, these are the core values you have to live by. And if we grow, and if we shift job to another company, they'll give another core value set. Maybe some of them are overlapping, but some of them are not. If you change three jobs, I'm sure we have 15 core values. But which is the right value? The company one or company two or company three? For each of them, they set up core values is right. But then, you as an individual, you have some values. Right? Institution also, if you look at as an individual, they have values. So your core values may be five, and you go and join, and they have five. They are 5 plus 5, 10. But God forbid if they don't match, you have 15 core values versus your 5. So which is the one that you have to live with? You are after all a human being. You can't be changing your values. Maybe you will develop, but you can't keep on shifting values. So to me, you need to have a set of values which is generally given by your parents perhaps, right? The upbringing, and you learn in your institutions. But you have a set of core values as a person, and that's what defines you. And that's what takes you long. So in this context, out of the 190 core values I was reading yesterday, I felt you need to have a couple of them, three of them, or four of them. You can look at it, introspect what you are. I don't say your every core value is same for everybody. A company says, yesterday I was meeting a company in Mumbai. They were saying one of their core values is modesty. I never heard it. Modesty being a core value. So they want, the chairman expects, every individual in the company to be modest. But if there is an aggressive guy by nature, if he joins them, can he be modest? So is he fitting a job? By core value, he's not. But is that a wrong core value to have? Being aggressive? I don't think. Being disrespectful, yes. But being aggressive, your marketing folks, sometimes you may have to be aggressive, right? So there is a conflict. So I looked at, as I told you, I'm not going to preach you what core values you should have. It's left to you. But I would take some examples of what I have learned in my life and leave it there for you to pick some budgets. I have listed about four things. Some of them are pretty common with what Mr. Mulyar was telling you. Adaptability. And I put three core values into one. Honesty, integrity, and being ethical. For me, all three are same. Okay? You got to have this. And passion. And passion is a big word. So you guys know. So have a passion. And the fourth one I have is learning. So these are the four core values which I have defined for myself and I stuck to them through all my journey, unknowingly. These are all the things I read in textbooks now, but unknowingly these things came to me. And I see there's nothing wrong. It's pretty good. Now I will tell you some incidents that I have gone through in my life, and see where these core values fit. In my speech, you may find to be a little immodest, because to deliver the message, I have to leave my modesty aside and boast about myself today for a while. Okay? Just to deliver the message, nothing else. I come from a small town in southern India, and I studied and my father is a school teacher. Come from a very lower middle class family. I studied all through my through the degree course in my mother tongue medium against my wish. but my mom did not have an English medium. So I had to go through my Moroccan medium. And then I come to Mumbai to do my technology. All of a sudden, I come from a small town into a metro city and go to an institution, India's best institution for technology. I land there and suddenly felt fish out of water. Number one, all these mobile cars, they speak in chest English, compact English, and I can't speak well, not even two sentences. So a couple of months was very, very hard on me, and a couple of my colleagues, similar background, they left. They left and went home. So I had a choice to make. Unfortunately, I was not empowered enough to take a choice because my parents sent me to Mumbai, that's it, no coming back. Right? So I had nobody to go back. So that's my place. One day I have learned that when there was a mathematics class, there was some equation and all that happening, and I had math background. I just solved it like a zippy. And these guys said, oh my god, yeah, these guys are brilliant. Then I realized, okay, it's not required to speak in English. It is good to solve mathematics. Then I will become known. Right? So that's the first lesson I learned, that don't be ashamed not knowing English. Especially the small town people have these problems. In my institution, I have seen that Mukesh Ambani was my senior. And such is the institution. Okay? And there I go from a small town. What do I do? But when I passed out after 3 years, I was third in the university and star in the class. But I could speak some English. Okay. When I went out, my professor told me, I registered myself for M.Tech. When he interviewed, he said, are you serious? You want to study M.Tech or you want to get out and take a job? I couldn't lie. So I said, I'll take a job. And then he said, then don't come to M.Tech. There are other serious students who are interested. They want to come. Then I said, can you find me a job there? Because the course that I did was food technology. Again, against my choice. I wanted to do some other technology, but I didn't get a seat. This is where I landed up. Then I studied food technology. I thought, but still not at my heart. So then what choice I have? My professor says, don't come for M.Tech. I wanted to go to M.Tech for one simple reason. I will get stipend. I needed it badly. He said, okay, I'll find you a job. Then he found me a job in some non-discrete company and it's not keen. But that's a different story. I wanted to cite this story to you. I'll connect it with towards the end, why I told you this story. Then I started my first job in a pharmaceutical company. By then, my modesty from a small town background started going down. And I started becoming arrogant. I was arrogant because I taught in the class, and all the colleagues in the class said, oh, anything you want on food and vegetable technology, go to Commission. These are the top guys. I said, oh, I'm top. Then I went and took up this job in a pharmaceutical company. They wanted some foods to be made. Then I saw all pharmacists are there, pharmacy technologists are there, big guys, and they don't know about food. And I come there as an extra, posing that I know everything, and I'm the only guy knowing about food. I became further arrogant. Then I left the job, and I joined another company, a real-time food processing company. In the interview, I thought I'm the top guy, I know everything, and I know anything in this world. And after the interview, I felt it the lowest in my life. Because the person who interviewed me was a doyen of the industry, which I did not know. So I was arrogant in my answers. Somehow he selected me, I joined. And later on I have learned, he is a respected figure of the top class institutions of the world, not just India. I was interviewed by him and I was so arrogant in front of him. I did not know. And then he cited these things after I joined in my induction. Said, no, this is not, unfortunately, this is what it is. People think they know, but they don't know. And then he further put me down. But let me tell you, today if I stand here, you know, giving a lecture to you, it's because of him. He taught me everything, how to think, you know, how to go deep into a problem. I worked in that company for 14 years. I can name that company. You have heard of Priya Pickles?
Yes.
That's the company. And everybody was my colleagues. Somebody was in Cadbury and somebody was in Britannia, the big pushing jobs, big brands. Where are you? I'm in Priya Pickles. Oh, I got then he said, and the family also, father and son. But I worked there for 14 years. And I never felt I'm working for the company. Such is the confidence I gained in that company because of this gentleman. What he made me feel is everything is a learning. So don't think it's an achar. And Cadbury is great, and it is not great. Just throw that out. What is important, every day you go to office, you go to factory, there's a new problem to solve. That's all matters. And then, the arrogant mind that I have, that I know everything, of course I knew a little, otherwise I would not have problem with anything. I applied all of that. And then I learned, okay, it's not enough to learn, but then apply. Became successful, then from nowhere I moved out to Delhi and took up a job with a multinational company. There I started to learn everything new and I was crestfallen in my life once again. When I joined that company, I went with a big hope that, oh, I'm joining an American company, I'll go to US, you know, for training and they will give me that, this. But then they said, okay, you have to work in meat industry. Oh my God! I never, meat is a choice that we can leave. Out of five questions that we answer in our technology paper, three are to be answered. So out of the two I left is meat, because I'm a vegetarian. Right? They said, you have to work in meat. Then what I do? I had only two choices. One, I accept and do, which I don't know anything of. Two is leave the job and go back. But then I can't go back. My background is such. There's nobody to go back. I made this choice to go to Delhi. Then if I go back, you would say, why did you go? So I had to accept it. Then the challenge in front of me was, what do I do? This company was supposed to be an expert, top-class company for meat producers, meat processors, providing ingredient solutions, etc. Then you go as an expert to sell your product. Then I say, I don't eat meat, but I'm an expert in telling you how to use it. So I don't carry any branding. So I made my choice that time. So when I went for training, they made me work in a meat lab. I touched meat for the first time. And I had to eat meat. Then I ate it. Then I came back and then started working and, now, cut short the story. I told you I have to boast about myself today. Today, 10 years after I did that, any meat company that starts in India, they first call me for an advice, including McDonald's, including Domino's, including Pizza. I still don't enjoy eating meat. And one of the companies those days I worked, who were in big problem, is in university. And I solved those problems, and they were so thankful, because I solved their problems. That is Winkies.
Winkies.
Poultry processing company. First time I entered a poultry processing company, all through my career while I was, the fruit and vegetable technology, that all mango processing, good fruits, good flavors, nice. Suddenly you go and see chickens being killed. And I have to say, how I improved it. Why I'm saying this is where I learned this value that you've got to adapt. If I had thought that, no, this is not the job I like, and they run away, come back to the old company. I'm sure they would not have taken me. Maybe I ended up somewhere. But what I thought that day was, of course, there was another saint who advised me, don't accept defeat. You are a food technologist. You have experience. You go contribute. So that's one day I closed my eyes and thought, what am I doing? What we are taught in our college is processing, right? Food is grown, processed to be a product, put into the market. That's all I have taken. The food could be a wheat, the food could be a rice, or a fruit, or a chicken. And that's processed. And processing is, you know, do some cutting, some mixing, and these are the operations. That's all is done, and that goes to the market. Once I took that philosophy, the aversion to meat has gone from my mind. This is when I learned how you adapt yourself. I'm not saying that one has to, you know, leave his dharma and, you know, dharma dashto gaya. My wife was not at all pleased that I was doing this. I said, okay, that gives me salary, so I'm doing it. And while I was successful there, and I was enjoying that success, another bomb comes in my life. They say, okay, you're not going to do this anymore. There's somebody else who will do this. Now we have to do something new. And this is a B2B company, and B2B for 200 years. That is DuPont. DuPont is the company which gave polyester, nylon, Teflon to this world. It's an invention-based company. They never sold any product to consumers. They only sell science, R&D to their customers who make products and go to market. And in our division, they said, oh, we have been working for so long, but we're still not enough. We're very small. Why? So let's try something else. We are in food. So we're telling our customers, my food is great, my ingredient is big, you use it, then you will do wonders. But they are not believing. Like a Hindustan Beaver or a Cadbury Ego, they hear our story, but they're not taking this, and so we are not growing. So my company said, why don't you go to market yourself, which is consumer marketing, which DuPont never did for 200 years, so it has to be done from scratch in a company who doesn't believe in consumer marketing. And I never did consumer marketing. I was always in operation, R&D, and things like that. So another bomb. And I said, do I have a choice? He said, no, you don't have a choice. Again, same paradigm. Do I accept it or be with it? No choice. I accepted it. Just step back a while I was doing this meat thing, my dissatisfaction was growing because I was doing something which is not in my heart. I was not happy. But doing and succeeding, that's fine. But at the end of the day, I'm not going happy home. So that time, I thought, okay, I need to deflect my thinking. So I got an MBA in International Management Institute so that I had my mind somewhere else. I completed MBA. I did not know why I was doing MBA. In fact, the professors asked, why are you coming? Just to add an MBA. Okay? I completed MBA, and then this bomb comes. Then I said, okay, I did MBA for nothing. So let me apply that and do consumer marketing. So I accepted it. And I did that reasonably successfully. I heard Shruti telling that she wants to go into advertising, and I was a brand manager at that time. A technical guy doing meat processing, fruit processing, getting into marketing, becoming a brand manager. Then I had to start everything from scratch. Learn, apply, and no time. Just 2 years. It's an experiment project. We have done it, we launched the product, all that was a history. It did well, but the company decided, no, enough, now we are going back. Stop it. Then another bomb. They said, we have to do something different to grow, not the routine jobs. What is that difference? Is India is 1 billion people, we are a nutrition company, India is deficient in nutrition. Why are we not succeeding then? We are selling only to top companies, top 10 companies. So why are we not going down and selling to everybody? So then came a theory called Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid. I don't know whether you guys heard about it. There's a textbook, Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid, co-authored by none other than C.K. Prahlad. You know C.K. Prahlad,
I think. Yes, sir.
You know that?
Yes, sir.
He wrote that book, and that's the theory. The theory is the big companies in the Western world are going to developing countries like India, taking their product and just putting it in the market. That's all. If somebody buys it, fine. If they don't buy, then they don't know what to do. But this is not the way. If you go down in the economic cycle and sell products to the people at the bottom of the economic period, that's where is the fortune. And then another professor who authored this book, Professor Stuart Hart, who was in Cornell University, he sold this story to our people in the US. They said, okay, it's a good story, let's try it in India. And they told that professor to go and do a study in India. So they came and started the study, and somewhere, somebody in the company has to take over the study. And then this bomb comes on my head again. I moved from my technology orientation to brand marketing, enjoying it, and suddenly I'm pulled out. I said, no, you have to go to the bottom of the pyramid and do something else. So the first time I thought, what is my life? Where am I going? I asked my boss, what are you doing for me? What wrong I have done? Because if I do different things like this, I will know, I not have a focused experience. What do I write in my CV? What am I? He said, this is an order, you have to take it. So again, no choice. I took it. And this project is to be done in slums of Mumbai. And a very remote village in another village where there is no connectivity, you have to train, go by train, then take a bus, and then walk on a block out, and then reach that village. This is where the project was being done. And I'm supposed to be the project leader. One of the key principles that C.K. Prahlad and Professor Stuart Hart said in this project is, you have to be very, very modest in this project, right? You can't be the corporate kind of a guy. Now, I come from a multinational 200-year-old corporate with success stories behind, and the little arrogance that I had that wherever I go, I'm Texaco. Now, suddenly I'm asked to be modest. So I went, I worked there 2 years, and I became modest. And we had to wind up that project. When we wound up, it was a tearful journey again, because we are working in the social groups and use them for our project, and we are leaving them and coming back. And here, the corporate guy in a coat and the laptop reading, goes in a flight, then go and tell them how to live. This is a big dichotomy in the mind fractions. So I had to switch off this corporate life and become a normal man. And at the end of it, I never imagined that I would meet C.K. Prahlad in life. You read his books, right? And that happened to me. They invited me to the University of Michigan for an international conference on bottom of the pyramid. There was who is who of the world assembled there, and C.K. was the main speaker, keynote delivery, and I was in front of him. And I was a panel member discussing what to be done in the bottom of the pyramid project in the world, and C.K. comes and shakes hands with me, and Professor Stuart Hart comes and shakes hands with me. I was shocked. What did I do? So great things in life. I never knew what I was doing. It meant a lot to them because we did it well, and this is only success story for their theory. They failed in Kenya, they failed in Nigeria, they failed in Mexico. And in India, our project was good. So I was a hero in their eyes. I did not know that. So they put me on the pedestal, international, big audience, clapping, oh, great. Again, that modesty is now valuing. Suddenly, what made me modest is make me arrogant again. Then I came back, Unfortunately, DuPont was going through that economic recession, global recession of 2008-9. They had to switch off all these projects which are only cost centers but not profit centers. They said, switch off this project. By then I was deep into it. I said, how can you switch off? No, it's not like I'm selling to Big Bazaar and then they're not paying me price, then I don't sell. It's not like that. It's we're linked with their life. But that's it, no money. And they're not leaving me. Big day in my life, because somehow I managed to get some funding and kept the project going for another year, and then slowly prepared these communities to be on their own, and then I got back. I came. When I come back, they say, okay, this project is over. Now you have to develop the next 5 years strategy for the business. This is another bomb. I never did strategy in my life. I lived as it comes. So now I have to make a strategy for a multinational company. We did it. That's implemented. Going well. All nice. Then of course I moved after 18 years of so many experiments. I come to a company called ICL, which is an Israel-based company. Similar story. They are not in India. They said, we are entering India. We want somebody to lead us, blah, blah, blah. Same story with all multinationals. Said, we have deep pockets. India is big, 1 billion people, same story. So if we can't do in India, where else we can do? But we, somebody needs to guide it. It comes my way. I took it. I'm doing it. But why I'm telling you this story? No matter what it right now. If I chose that I want to be a particular company, I had interviews in Britannia, Cadbury's and all, in some I was selected, some not. Some of my colleagues have gone. Without being disrespectful to anybody, and that day I was crestfallen. Let me tell you, I went to my institute back and said, this education did not give me a good job. I'm nobody. I'm having small jobs and small companies. You're not good. This is what I told my professor. But when I look back, none of my colleagues who went through these big companies, Britannia's and Cadbury's and all, I can't find them today where they are. But somebody Googles BOP conference 2007, my name pops up. So am I successful or my friend is successful? How do I define my success? Right? Today, a company like McDonald's, they're having a new product issue. They call me. So am I successful? I don't know. But that gives me pride. Right? The top companies are consulting me. That's great. Why? I don't know. I really don't know. But only one thing I look back and see why it happened to me is maybe out of no choice, but today I'm preaching this as a choice. I was crazy. I was just crazy. I didn't say I was a technical guy, R&D guy, so I need to only work with molecules in the labs. When opportunities came, I said, okay, go and do something new. And doing the meat from nowhere, for a vegetarian, the shop, doing retail, working with slums, I tell you I had to sit on the floor, right? And no bed to sleep. I had to stay with those ladies. And from this cushy corporate life, five-star hotels, I go there. But I enjoyed it. Maybe my nature was that, I don't know. But this is the flexibility part I talk, this is the adaptability part I talk. And at the same time, ethics and integrity that I talked about, that comes from my family, that comes from the companies also that I work for, they never ever allow you to be unethical, sidestep a process and do something different. So these are the things which I look back and find made me what I am. Okay? And yesterday, I was in Mumbai doing a strategy review for my present company. And my boss tells me, we're going through a turbulent phase right now. I joined just 2 years, already turbulence. all the dreams we wanted to do are gone, no money. But we made a plan and showed him. He said he's responsible for India, Middle East, and Africa, the emerging economies. He told me at the end of the thing, I don't know when we do these investments, but this kind of plan I don't see anywhere. I'm going back very, very satisfied that there's so much quality in India. I mean, my colleagues and I did it. And he said, I don't get it in Africa. I don't get it in Egypt. They only talk, but they don't give me a satisfaction. He went back with satisfaction. And last June, I was in my headquarters in Germany. And when I entered, oh, India, the gentleman, oh, great, you're doing a great job. Oh, I don't know what great I'm doing. We're just $5 million business we made in 5 years, 2 years, that's it. But why I'm saying this is, again, linking to, I want to be modest today, is I just stuck to my principles. I did nothing more. Just stuck to my principles, what I know, what I've learned in my institutes, kept on implementing them. And of course, in my MBA, I've learned strategy. You people also learn strategy, right? I'm only implementing them. I'm doing nothing new. I did not forget those lessons. I'm just taking all those chapters and putting a strategy back. That's it. So that, for me, is learning. Learning and applying. Generally, what we do is we go up to institutions, colleges, run after the jobs and growth and promotions, and somewhere we forget our roots. So these are the things I have learned. And I do not know how successful I am, but this is where my social standing, corporate standing is. I would like you to watch a small video, just a minute, doesn't take more than that, and then I'll take another 5 minutes, and that's the end of my speech.
Finally, an opportunity for Keralites to enjoy their own state. Moving on to another state is the business with a social model. A group of women in a remote village in Warangal has started a food business. But here is where it gets interesting. The food is fortified with vitamins and is being served with a side of education on nutrition. Vishwanath Pillai and Sandeep Shrikar getting more details.
These women are neither corporates nor business school graduates, but they share the same enthusiasm and spirit of enterprise as their urban peers. These are poor, semi-illiterate women of Palathagiri Mandal in Warangal district who are working on a unique business model. The model is simple. The women prepare and sell nutritious food to local communities. Their food comes with a twist. They provide awareness on nutrition to local communities. The Palathagiri Mandal, which falls under the cotton belt, is one of the poorest regions in Andhra Pradesh where malnutrition is rampant. For this, they are helped by the Soleil Company, which is a subsidiary of DuPont, along with US-based Cornell University and a local NGO, Mari. The institutes provide the technical and managerial support for this group. So the women cook food in a traditional way, but fortify it with protein and vitamins.
ఒప్పించడం మెప్పించడం రుచి చూపెట్టడం ఇది మేము తల్లి నూనెలతోని ప్రోటీన్ వేయడం.
The group consists of 21 women who say they now feel a sense of pride in what they do. They aptly call themselves Samata champions. Samata means equality. The group has adapted a corporate setup and it has an organizational structure and management systems in place. The group expects to reach financial sustainability sometime next year. They are also planning to get venture capital funding soon.
Co-creation is a model of co-creating business models together with the communities that are involved in the best of the parent space.
This model is not just tasty but nutritious too. The women here are trying out a unique business model which not only empowers them but also addresses the larger issue of malnutrition. In Anarun Sharif, in Warangal district, Vishnath Pilla.
Finally, an opportunity for Keralites to enjoy their own state. Moving on to...
Okay, the intention, my intention to show this to you is to talk about the modesty thing. You have seen those men there? they are all in green sarees. That is the uniform that they created for themselves. They created a brand for themselves. It's called Samatha. They put a brand. Samatha asked, why did you do that? They said, Samatha is inclusion. Of course, this is all 2 years of working with them, you know, teaching them about management principles. And one lady you have seen writing on the chart, and she keeps all the account books. And she does P&L of the group, right? And there's another lady who spoke, small one, she's a widow. And the family disowned her, and she lives in a very socially bad condition. And that lady, during my training, I had to tell them a little bit about nutrition, how to market, empower them. It's not that I go and do it. Rohit is about empowering them, and then they go and do the things, themselves. One day I was finding it difficult to explain them what protein does, how it looks like. I can't explain a chemical molecule to them. I was telling it in a simplistic way, and that lady, uneducated, she said, I asked, do you understand? She said, yeah, I understand. Tell me, what do you understand? She said, it's like a, then she took out the gold chain. She said, like this chain, all polymers linked together. So depending on the link, the protein varies. I tell you, even today, I suffer to explain this to even the most educated R&D members. And she said that. And also, why this protein is different, I had to tell them. She said, yeah, simple. It's a mobile number. So you change one number, it changes. Such kind of brilliance is existing in those worlds. But they have no opportunities. And that's when I said, I had all the opportunities. I was complaining, right? I didn't get a good job. I was not vice president somewhere. But all the opportunities were with me, in spite of coming from a lower middle class background. Nowhere had I to suffer, and I stay in all big five-star hotels all over the world and see the talent that sits there. And they have no opportunity. And all the management lessons, of course, they can't speak English, that's a different issue. They were talking about promotion of the product, communications, branding, brand messaging, accounting, everything. But it pained a lot when I had to leave that project and said, now we have run out of funding, so only you guys manage this. So this is where I understood why modesty is required as a core value in our lives. You know, professionalities. Somewhere, same project we have done in Mumbai, in slums, here. Great story again, and those ladies are still selling nutrition to an NGO in Colaba for pregnant women who are very poor, and their children, they are not born healthy. They started selling these nutritious foods to them, and still continuing after we left also. So what I learned from here is, if you really are willing to learn, are willing to apply, I think satisfaction comes on its own. It's not about the job, it's not about the salary. Both these things are important. I'm not saying these things are not important. So at the end of the day, like Ms. Munjal said, believe in yourself, be flexible, adapt to any situation, any environment, and above all, have a passion. Have a passion for something. So today, as I told you, that meat thing I left. I don't like eating meat anymore, but the passion still drives me, so I keep calling, I do work there. Similarly, these ladies still call me for some advice out there, though we are not in the project. That gives me immense satisfaction. I'm not a managing director in DuPont, but I feel very blessed and very successful because of this. So I leave this full speech at this stage and leave you to take what you want to take from this, and I'm open to any questions if you have. Thank you very much.
So you commenced your speech by saying that picking out core values, few of them might be overlapping with the company core values, and at times it won't be overlapping. Like you just mentioned the case in Mumbai where the marketing manager, I believe, was aggressive by nature and the company's core value was modesty. So in that case, what should an individual do? Go for the core values of the company or go for the core values an individual possess?
Well, if you don't follow the core values of the company, you will be sacked anyway, right? Either you follow or you seem to be following, right? You have to. But you never, ever sacrifice on your personal values. Never. So if you follow them, you, any core value in addition to company's core value is good only, right? I'm not saying there will be bad core values which you follow and the company will not like it. The question of 190 core values are there, you have to choose some. You can't follow all 190, right? So they may have three. So they have modesty, that's fine. And if you don't have modesty, also it's fine. The only thing is, what the chairman expects is, when you are in front of the customers or partners or stakeholders, don't be aggressive. Don't boast about yourself. That's what he means. Right? So that's the modesty. So in context, we have to do it. So you have to follow all the rules. If some company says you have to follow ethics and you want to give bribe, then you're out.
Thank you, sir, for telling us that how untied passion is vital in achieving what we wish for. A successful person is the one who understands the importance of adaptability, honesty, integrity, and being ethical. We hope these key mantras are fruitful to our student managers. Thank you once again, sir.